thank you so much. This is such a great crowd here today. I know we bribe you with pizza, but really, it's the artwork you all came to see. I feel honored to have Jonathan Jackson here talking about his beautiful show. And I'm not going to spend too much time because I want Jonathan to just take over. You can tell yourself, talk about yourself, and I don't need to do that. So. Mm-hmm. Thanks very much, everyone.
Lunch is a very important time of day. That's where we're gonna begin. So please, you know, at any point if you need more, get the pizza. I'm happy to be the pizza party man. And I just wanna say thank you to Joan and Cameron, wherever Cameron is, for their assistance during the installation. It was a beautiful process, and thank you to the GCC faculty for inviting me and for always presenting, you know, such a warm welcome to campus. As this figure behind me is working, pulling material from the body, I think it's always helpful to begin a conversation around art with acknowledging the conditions of our body. So in a very loose way, I'm just going to, can you hear? Project a little more. Okay, yeah. I told Mike, I'll try for the opera, for the opera training in the diaphragm. How is that, Jen? Good? A little bit better? Okay. Thank you for that. Again, conditions of the body. So. This practice of sort of somatic listening, you know, I'm gleaning from an artist named Mary Kelly, who developed concentric pedagogy. But just for the first maybe 2 minutes of this presentation, I'm going to think about where I'm coming in from in my body today. And I invite you to just mentally collect yourself, you know. So if I begin droning on and on, you know, like you can situate yourself in your seats in this place. So a first condition, I'm fresh off a plane, off a red eye flight back to Massachusetts. So I landed in Logan at 7 a.m. this morning and then drove straight here. And so I'm feeling tired, in a sense, out of the usual, like a little bit dislocated from time. I feel like my body's catching up to me, like where my mind is in the moment. Some other conditions of what I'm thinking about today, I've been really observing the new moon in a particular way. It's been a very beautiful formation of the moon for the past couple of days, and I've been feeling a kind of southern pulling in my stomach. Some other conditions, I'm thinking about being back in this place, in this landscape of Greenfield, Massachusetts, where I lived for a short period of time between college and graduate school. And something that we'll go through, I'm still just sort of warming up, letting people gather in, and Susie is my point of contact for if I'm being loud enough or if I'm getting too low. Do you just give me the, raise the volume. To give you some scaffolding for the slides that we'll look at, I'm gonna speak about my work in two parts primarily, two long form parts, and then I'll talk about this installation, how I was thinking about the formation of it, the content of the images, and what is happening with the sound work that is in the space. So these first few images that I'm showing are from a really foundational period, you know, me being an undergraduate student. And the slides that I'll show from this point on will not be dated, but the images are in chronological order, so to speak. So you can imagine, you know, as I speak about some of the concepts today, you know, this flow of time between 2014 to present day, to this present moment in the exhibition. And a lot of my work really begins with again, thinking through the body, looking at the body, and sort of in a very adolescent way, thinking about, you know, what forms of racialization, queerness, identity, what sort of national, global, as well as private things are mapped onto my own figure. That is my real sort of basis, you know, to begin making photographs. I was photographing myself a lot. I wanted to show this photograph in particular because this photograph is made in Bennett Meadow, right along the Connecticut River, just before Northfield. And when I was living in Greenfield, it was 2019 into 2020, so there was the slow realization of the oncoming pandemic. I was working in Greenfield Coffee and the Florence Pie Bar, customer service, and I was primarily just sort of wandering through the landscape of this region, wandering into different pockets where I could take walks on a daily basis to sort of give myself some company. And so this double exposure was kind of a photographic accident that happened in my small frame, you know, 35 millimeter camera. But upon developing the film and making some prints of this image, the doubled figure provided a sort of visual metaphor for some things that I was thinking about at the time and still continue to think about, and will structure our talk or my talk today. So thinking about haunting, memory, silence, and I think most importantly, double consciousness in relationship to W.E.B. Du Bois. Those are some concepts that we'll work through today. At the end of the talk, I'll start to narrate some of the content in the images, you know, present in this exhibition. So I have some slides at the end, and I'll sort of spotlight some key photographs. But my imagination is like we'll be able to get the lights back up, and we can have more of like a, you know, roundtable discussion about what's happening in the space. In addition to concepts around memory, looking at my own work, thinking through my own photographic practice, I will be gleaning information from these three scholars throughout the talk: Michelle Roftrio, Toni Morrison, and Sadia Hartman, and knowledge around their, you know, their own canon of work, I'm not assuming. And so I will engage in a practice of close reading with these three scholars as I go on. How are we feeling in this moment? Good? Ready to go in? Okay. To go further back in the past, so back beyond, you know, my own formation, my own birth in 1996, I wanted to think about, you know, what are some origins outside of myself for this practice or for my being, being an artist. And one point of entry where I really see the origin of myself as a person is related to this book. So in 1827, my fifth great-grandfather, Robert Roberts, publishes this book with the short title, The House Servant's Directory. And this book is a facsimile reproduction of the original typeface. So the entire book is, you know, republished, and this is the original frontispiece with the full title. And some words that jump out to me here, of course, are the art of waiting, observing, careful counsel, careful compiled counsel for house servants and the leaders of houses. So some context around this book and some context around the early 19th century in Boston. My ancestor was a free man of unknown origin. In my research and in other scholarly work around this book. It's unknown if he was born enslaved and was emancipated or manumitted, or if he was born free. But by 1827, he had landed in Boston. He was living in Beacon Hill, a neighborhood off of the Boston Common. And he was working primarily as a domestic servant in the households of several Federalist politicians and governors in Massachusetts. And this book is a guidebook for the practice of household service. So the first half of the book is direct narration to two younger black men who he knows will be entering the profession of household service. And then the second half is a list of over 100 recipes and tricks and tips and tools for the trade. Some other context around this period, and just sort of, you know, so we're all in this kind of general knowledge around slavery in Massachusetts in particular. Massachusetts abolishes slavery in 1783. And we can think about that fact or look at that fact in two directions. In the first direction, on paper, this meant that the state government of Massachusetts, through several legal cases, outlawed the practice of slavery, deemed slavery unconstitutional per the state government's constitution. On the ground, in another direction, this legislation, you know, was carried out in very independent manners. So although the state abolishes slavery in 1783, the practice of enslavement, and I would say the business of slavery, continues into the 19th century, right? So not only are people, enslaved Africans, physically present in houses, some people are manumitted into indentured servitude, contract work, apprenticeships for life. There are many cases related to that. But there is also, because this is an early abolition, a forming free black middle class, particularly within Boston in the urban centers, forming in the early 19th century. And my ancestor is a kind of pivotal figure in this time period, both because he was a writer and published his work, was commercially published, but also because he was a political agent in the community. A large debate during the 1830s was a debate around African immigration. You know, if we receive emancipation, do we stay in the United States, or do we return to Africa to form the colony that would become Sierra Leone, right? So this is the sort of, you know, political atmosphere of the period that this book is published in. As he is writing the book and compiling the book, he is working in this home, which was the home of Christopher Gore, and he worked there for 2 years, from 1827 to 1829. And after his tenure at this house, he never again worked as a domestic servant. So this book was kind of the capstone to his practice, right? Jumping ahead to 2019, I come into knowledge of this text. This is not a text that I, you know, was a family heirloom that was passed down, you know, between the generations of my family. This is something that I discover after I have moved myself from Detroit, Michigan to Massachusetts. And I begin reading his work, reading his language, thinking about this historical figure a lot. And most importantly, the home of Christopher Gore now stands today as a preserved house museum. So this house is in Waltham, Massachusetts, and I began photographing in that preserved space on a weekly basis for about 2 years. So, some things about Gore Place itself. As a house museum, the site compiles certain levels of fiction and truth, right? So there are objects in the home that are period to Christopher Gore and the Gore family, period to Robert Roberts, my ancestor, and other laborers who worked in the house. But there is a lot of work and a lot of objects that are recurated back into the home to give the appearance of what it would look like in the early 19th century, right? So there is a mix of things to look at, things to intake that give you a glimpse of the past, but also construct a story, construct a narrative, construct a fiction. In my engagement with the space, thinking again about, you know, how I photograph my own body, I begin to interact with the spaces and the objects that Roberts details in his book. So I follow his path of egress from his bedroom, which is sort of reset up. You know, these are not objects that he would have actually had. And I move with him through the spaces that he would have moved through during his day. And in the book, he sequences the beginning of the work from rising early in the morning, opening up the house, preparing the house to be visited by guests, be seen, all the way to shutting down the house at night. So he is the first to wake and the last to rest. And in the house, my attention began to fall on a couple of things. One, I was thinking about how to represent myself in the space, you know, how should my figure appear? And then I began to think about what are the material traces that are left in the space that speak more to my ancestors' experience than the narrative that is leading the house's curation, right? And so my attention begins to really fall on windows, mirrors, reflective surfaces, clocks, chairs. Of course, objects that would be handled by people. So teacups, pots, silverware. And my own body appears in several kind of phantom-like repertoires in this group of images. So as you saw before, my figure is reversed. I continually wear these sort of contemporary clothing, a dark blue shirt, gray slacks, black shoes. And these cotton gloves are actually not a period mirror to what my ancestor would have worn, but it was a requirement by the house, right, for me to work in the space and to actually handle the archival objects, right? So the gloves become this, for me, a visual symbol that tether me to my ancestor, but also make this phantom figure appear as both a curator, a caretaker, a servant in the space. And so there are layers that I think through with those gloves in particular. As I said before, you know, looking for spaces that have been halted in their preservation or frozen in time. So many rooms in the house, you know, they were able to manufacture the same wallpaper that would have been in the space, and so they re-wallpaper walls. But then some spaces are left open, as in this room. And, you know, of course, again, my figure flows in and out in the phantom-like repertoire of being a shadow. To think through a concept or a word that, you know, is structuring this work, silence, I wanted to bring in the work of Michel Roth Triot. In 1995, he publishes Silencing the Past, which is really a close look at the historical formation of the Haitian Revolution in particular. But in the introduction of the book, he details how silences function as an activating verb in the study of history. And so in the spirit of close reading, I'll quote him just to define how he thinks about silences. Quote, silences enter the process of historical production at four crucial moments: the moment of fact creation, the making of sources, the moment of fact assembly, the making of archives, the moment of fact retrieval, the making of narratives, and the moment of retrospective significance, the making of history in the final instance. And when I think with Trio and I think about this space, the House Museum itself, to me, becomes a representational body for observing how silences function, right? So within those four moments that he describes, the House Museum simultaneously acts as the place where it happened, right? Or the place of the event, so it is the source, the referent. It constructs a narrative, its curation constructs a narrative, and its public engagement broadcasts that narrative as history, right? And so the space of the House Museum is a complicated space, particularly in relationship to enslavement and black labor, as well as, you know, the space produces a kind of fiction. So some of the objects that you're seeing in these photographs, you know, again, are period objects. Others are reproductions. So everything on this table that my head is resting on are contemporary reproductions of a wax stamp or this particular kind of candle system, you know, that would have been pooled and measured for specific amounts of time. And these are things that are just produced, you know, as in the industry of history. You know, there's fake food in the house and fake liquid, and scenes can be staged with objects to give the appearance of a certain kind of reality. And in any way that I could, I began to really, you know, focus my attention on the material traces of what's really sort of left behind in the house. So over time, you know, my participation as a figure, as a phantom in the space began to diminish, and these other traces began to sort of take larger form. And something that I'll think about in this next section, you know, something happening in this space that I think is contentious and I'm still thinking about, is that my own body, you know, because my personhood is censored or erased, or, you know, the naming of this figure as a character does not happen in this work, the body then becomes another vessel, right? So the body is existing in this same language of objectification as equal to the material objects in the house. So this idea about being a tethered vessel, you know, that both, you know, I can enact in this space as a free agent, you know, five generations after my ancestor, and yet I am also tethered to the space because of my relationship to him, and my relationship to this history of labor in particular. The second section that I'll move through, I'll present some questions that extend some things that began to happen as I was photographing at Gore Place. And I was really thinking about, you know, how do I extend this relationship with material history? How do I find more stories to engage with outside of my own autobiography? And how do I stretch my historical imagination back even further, right? So my ancestor's book, you know, really acts as a rupture of a silencing gesture, a silencing force. He had the agency to document his experience, and now that book is still used today, right, to almost in every house museum of the region and several places outside this region use that book to structure their curation of the house, you know, to make a house look like it's within the 19th century. But I was thinking, how do I go back further, back to the really sort of ad hoc period in this region where, you know, there was a lot of fluid motion between enslaved labor and free labor, there's a lot of fluid motion between identity. You know, this concept of blackness as I present today, you know, is formed, can be sort of identified in a specific period. And I wanted to think about that more. Think about sort of the unlikely possibilities that happened within New England. And I wanted to go back, you know, into the 18th century and into the 17th century, really to think about the early settlers, indigenous people in this area, and their relationships. And so two things really took hold. I began photographing in any historically preserved space in the region of Vermont, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, that claims a black history. You know, any public-facing institution, house, museum, that claims some history either related to enslavement, abolition, emancipation, labor, I wanted to get access to it to see it. And then the second formation that really is more conceptual, I began thinking with Toni Morrison as a writer, and I began rereading her work in a really close way. And so I wanted to share just some of her own language.
You use a lot of memory from ancestors somehow in the book, do you not? I mean, do you believe in that? Do you believe that ancestors that you have not known can be still coming through us, working through us, and we retain some memory?
I do now.
Of them? You do now?
I do now. My whole education, you know, was to make sure I didn't believe things like that, and I dismissed all sorts of things that were indigenous in my family, superstition and, you know, the discredited information, the discredited way of knowing that discredited people always have. But when I began to write, that was the place where I had to go. That's where the information was. That's where the images were. That's where the language, the color came in these tales, folk tales, attitudes, the normal, easy acceptance of signs. And then things began to happen that were really quite startling.
That interview was televised in 1988 after the publication of Beloved in 1987. And for the sake of time, I won't detail the entire plot of Beloved, but obviously it is now a, you know, a canonized classic text. To think about post-colonial study, to think about memory, to think about movement from the autobiographical slave narratives, you know, which really had an explosion between the 1830s and the 1850s before the Civil War. So, you know, if this is a book that has always been on your long read list, I say, like, get it up to the top. But in lieu of summarizing the plot and the historical figure that it is based on, I wanted to read just one paragraph where Morrison brings in this term rememory, you know, into the scope of the novel. And it's a short passage of dialogue. And something that happens before the protagonist, Setha, says these words, her daughter, Denver, is approaching the house that they live in. And she says that she regards the structure of the house as a person rather than an architectural object. So she's coming into the house and she's reading the emotional space of the home. She sees Setha, the protagonist, kneeling on the floor. She assumes she's praying and she asks her, what was she praying for? And this continues on from that. So, quote, I was talking about time. It's so hard for me to believe in it. Some things go, pass on. Some things just stay. I used to think it was my rememory. You know, some things you forget, other things you never do. But it's not. Places are still there. If a house burns down, it's gone. But the place, the picture of it, stays. and not just in my memory, but out there in the world. What I remember is a picture floating around out there outside my head. I mean, even if I don't think it, even if I die, the picture of what I did or knew or saw is still out there, right in the place where it happened. And something that proceeds on from that dialogue that is fascinating to me is the protagonist tells her daughter, because of this phenomenon of memory, she can never go back to the place where it happened, right? Because it will happen again. What feels interesting to me in Morrison's formation is that she is doing that exact thing to construct the narrative of the novel, right? So Morrison herself has to situate her imagination in the past, in the scene of subjection, right, where violence is enacted, in the interior mind of the enslaved. So this idea of rememory was very stimulating to me at this time as I began to visit these spaces, because I want to think about, you know, how can I encounter memories that are not my own, memories that are floating out around in space. The photographs you'll see, you know, have a slight aspect ratio change in a material way. This is where I really pick up the large format view camera in my practice. I'm mentioning this because I know there are photo students, you know, in the room. And beyond the, you know, like pleasurable romance I have like with that object, what I really was seeking was the optical control over the negative, right? So a really intense control over how I shape the light, how I shape my focus, and how I can draw an eye across the frame. As I said, you know, as I was exiting out of Gore Place, the house servant's directory, my figure has faded away completely now, and I'm behind the camera. And the only thing that I'm really doing in this space is slightly manipulating the objects to give the appearance that someone has just left the frame, right? That these objects are handled, are alive. And something that I think that, you know, the materiality of the large format negative provides is this sort of sense of volume, you know, in the photograph coming from the object. So the photographs to me are hyper sensual, right? And they depict an encounter, a close observation with one singular object set in space. As I began photographing in these houses, it was in 2020, in the wake of, you know, the global pandemic, as well as the global Black Lives Matter movement, Black Lives Matter protests, and all of these commemorative spaces were beginning to grapple with their public engagement with Black life, right? So some spaces, you know, had been doing research, had curation, interpretation around the enslaved presence in their homes. Some were just beginning in 2020. And what was convenient, I guess, for me in this time is, you know, that afforded me a lot of access to the space as a thought collaborator with those curators, historians working in spaces, in these spaces. But it also gave me a certain level of privacy in the space. So within my engagement with them, until I had built, you know, a significant relationship with a house, I typically would be locked inside the house for a handful of hours and given permission around what I could and could not touch, right? So what begins to happen in these still life photographs are these very slow and gradual reshaping and reframing of certain objects and areas in the home. And as an editorial choice, you know, when I began to circulate these photographs and share them, to, I guess, distance myself from the pedagogical responsibility of interpretation, right? The work of being a historian. I do not name the spaces that these photographs are taken within, right? I do not name the historical figures that I'm imagining or researching at the time, and I do not name the provenance of the objects. And this is, for me, something that separates this group of work from the House Servants Directory, where I have a very personal relationship with the material. Here, there are levels of silence that, you know, even myself as an artist or an informed participant observer cannot overcome, right? And I feel like my mission or intention in the photographs is different than the public interpretation of the House Museum. And something that comes from that sort of anonymous shaping of space is that it creates, I can think of like the visual metaphor or folktale of the witch hut, right? Baba Yaga's hut, a house of endless rooms, like a house that continues to keep growing and building. And so each photograph is only accompanied with a short title or caption, just naming the technical, you know, name of the object present. And I wanted to pull back for a moment and just sort of, let me check my time. Joan, are we doing good? Okay. Okay, keep going. I wanted to talk about, you know, so I'm showing these photographs, you know, as they are in a kind of finished state, and I have an exhibition photograph that I'll share, but I wanted to showcase, you know, the sort of iterative process around how I think about handling the objects, especially for students in the room, because sometimes you come across something that is really vocal, right, and you feel attracted to, and you know you need to make an image of it, but in my process, it can take a couple of weeks, even months, until I feel like I've determined, you know, or found the final iteration of any image in particular. And what I'll lead to is detailing a photograph of an object that I pulled from this space, this attic, which the spaces of attics and cellars are really important spaces for me in preserved homes. One, because that's usually where they have created storage space. And so there are a lot of things to look at in that space. The second reason why they're important is that within New England, save for one location, which I'll talk about in relationship to this exhibition, many homes, you know, if people were of a certain class and they could afford to have enslaved servants, there is a kind of concept of this idea of family slavery happening in this region. So the enslaved peoples, you know, were not isolated or set into a quarters, you know, separate from the main house, which is similar to, you know, the antebellum South. Rather, they were living inside the homes and most times were housed in the attic space or in the cellar, right? So those are two zones that I always go to first to see what I find. In this attic space, I came across this manacle. And you know, when I think about the vocality of an object, you come across this and you know, I have to figure this out in some kind of way. I have to deal with, you know, my eye went straight to it the first time I went into that attic. And it's a deeply charged object, a deeply sensual object as well. And I spent, you know, several weeks thinking about how do I make a photograph of this manacle. And I'm showing this outtake, which doesn't, you know, circulate in exhibition space, but this is the first iteration, you know, my first time handling it. And, you know, for the photo students in the room, there are several, you know, technical things when I get this negative back that are amiss for me, right? So my frame is too high. My focus is falling really across this chest rather than between the two cuffs, and the figure is backlit. So on a formalistic level, you know, I was not satisfied with this image. But in relationship to Toni Morrison and this idea of rememory and this idea of encountering memory outside yourself, something was amiss in this gesture, you know, that I had practiced so much in the house servant's directory, right? The kind of disembodied figure coming in to the frame and caressing the object or inviting a viewer to think about the feeling of the object. In relationship to this contact, I felt that the contact rushed the image towards violence, right? So in some ways, it's kind of a one-note story, right? Despite, you know, whatever technical merit there is in the photograph, the narrative is isolated only around violence. And this is the last iteration of my handling with the manacle. And what became important, or what I discovered in, you know, this relationship of the contact of the black figure with the charged object, was this idea of releasing the objects from the home, right? Trying to release the reading of violence that is so laced in the space, laced in the interior of the space, and release them into the landscape. And in relationship to this choice, I wanted to share sort of two parallel quotes between Toni Morrison in the 1980s and Sadia Hartman in 2008, you know, who is a writer who's really thinking through these things in the present. And I hold these two thoughts sort of side by side in relationship to this problematic of a reading of violence. So in an essay that is titled The Site of Memory, which is a short essay about Beloved, Toni Morrison writes, quote, "These people, the enslaved, are my access to me. They are my entrance into my own interior life, which is why the images that float around them, the remains, so to speak, at the archaeological site, surface first. And they surface so vividly and so compellingly that I acknowledge them as my route to a reconstruction of a world, to an exploration of an interior life that was not written, and to the relation of a kind of truth. So the nature of my research begins with something as ineffable and as flexible as a dimly recalled figure, the corner of a room, a voice." And I connect this thought to an essay that Sadia Hartman publishes called Venus in Two Acts in 2008. And she writes in a similar way, "This writing is personal because this history has engendered me, because the knowledge of the other marks me, because of the pain experienced in my encounter with the scraps of the archive, and because of the kind of stories I have fashioned to bridge the past and the present and to dramatize the production of nothing, empty rooms and silence and lives reduced to waste." And within this essay, in relationship to this photograph and others, and photographs in this exhibition, a question that Hartman poses, I kind of hold as my center, like my core quest right now as a maker. She asks, how does one revisit the scene of subjection without replicating the grammar of violence, replicating a grammar of violence, right? So how do we go to the place where it happened, as Toni Morrison authors and Beloved, and analyze that space without replicating the violence that was enacted within it. One thing that I'll talk about just in exhibition form, and then I'll really get into these photographs, is in addition to thinking about releasing the objects, taking them outside of the homes without permission, situating them in sequences with contemporary scenes, contemporary, you know, kind of phantom figures, like in this exhibition, I also begin to pair my photographs with sound, right? To activate another sensorial state in the viewing of an exhibition. And I'll see if this can play just very briefly. This is an iteration that I'm building on in this exhibition. So, in this exhibition or in this, you know, little showcase, there are five speakers recessed underneath the framed photograph. So, the same speakers that you see in this space, you know, were recessed into the wall underneath the photograph. And as you saw in that quick little video, the sound would kind of pan back and forth across the wall, right? So if someone is walking along the exhibition or along the sequence of the photographs, they might hear the handling of an object, the sound of my footsteps in these preserved houses, or that vocal narration, which I snatched or appropriated from a lecture that Hortense J. Spillers delivered in the early 2000s. And she is an important literary critic in relationship to Toni Morrison. And what you saw sort of at the end of that video, you know, there was an engagement that I really was fascinated by, that, you know, someone would come to the photographs and take them in, you know, for the 15 seconds you get, you know, of someone looking at your work. And then they would turn their head and place their ear very close to the glass, right? So I wanted to think about, you know, how to extend this relationship between the visual haptic and the sonic. And I wanted to keep them as, you know, separate elements, you know, not to think about cinema or film, moving image just yet, but to think about, you know, what happens when you look at an image, you watch an image, and you also are intaking a specific sonic register. And what began to happen in relationship to the houses again, so I really started to photograph in the landscape surrounding the grounds of each home. Okay, so this is bringing us up to this exhibition, and I've already spoken a little bit about, you know, my intention around pairing sound in this space, and this time having, you know, a more sort of apparent visual apparatus for the sound in this exhibition. But to talk about just the content of the photographs before we break open for conversation, these are all photographs primarily made in 2023, just last year. And I wanted to think about, yeah, how to extend my work into the real world, or to extend my work, my method, into a contemporary, like a real contemporary present. And as well, I think, and it's important, I think, to say this, like, working in the archives of racial slavery is intense and emotional and taxing. And I wanted to feel some looseness from those spaces for some time. So what I began to do over the year, I was just wandering around the places that I live. So I live now in Millis, Massachusetts. And I began photographing inside my house, around the grounds of my house, yard, I should say, grounds makes it seem immense. And I began to photograph people, Black people in particular, in moments that awakened my historical imagination. So I'm still thinking through this question with Hartman, you know, is a certain grammar of violence being replicated in these photographs, or is there a release? And so the figures that you see in this exhibition, majority are strangers, But there are two photographs of my family that I'll contextualize. And something happening with these window photographs. There are windows from my home in Millis. And then the covered windows are windows from the Royal House and Slave Quarters in Medford, Mass, which is the only standing existing structure of slave quarters in New England. And so on my visit there, I just photographed each of the windows inside the slave quarters. And I'll narrate, I suppose, three photographs throughout the exhibition. I kind of feel like there are a couple of spaces in the show, you know, some commonalities between images. So there are figures in the landscape, tending the land, working in the land, gardening, farming. And then there are two photographs sort of directly related to my own family. And this photograph that, you know, is centered in the exhibition, I think, is an important one. These are my great aunts, Christine and Charlene. My father's family is primarily in Rhode Island, and they live in Providence. And my aunt Christine on the left here is kind of the principal family historian. She is the person who introduced me to the directory when I was, you know, she was like looking at my little self-portraits and thinking like, okay, you should check this little bit of information that I found out. And between her and my late grandfather, Frederick, they've compiled a really kind of serious amount of research about our paternal ancestors, which are split between European settlers, African immigrants, either enslaved or free, and the Narragansett tribe in Rhode Island. And in this photograph, they are holding a Bible that belonged to Benjamin Roberts, who was Robert Roberts' son. And in this time, these sort of large Bibles became these tomes of family history, right? So this page is open to births and deaths, and they're sort of recordings. The book is really sort of written in the 1840s. And the Bible was, you know, under my aunt's possession, and it was really deteriorating, right? Like, you know, this is a sheepskin cover, organic material, parchment paper beginning to fade. And she really wanted to get it placed into an archive to halt its deterioration. I organized an acquisition with the Museum of African American History. I felt like that would be the more suitable space for this object than Gore Place. The Museum of African American History is in Beacon Hill, a block away from the site that my ancestor actually lived in, his permanent home. And of course, the schoolhouse would have been the meeting house for all of the political, you know, activism or political awareness, liveliness, and worship for the Black community in Boston. So this Bible lives there now. But it is a kind of fraught idea, right? Because now we no longer have access, open access, to the object that pertains to us, right? It's in a protected protected space now, but it also is under lock and key and has re-entered an institution, you know, which could have a variety of different levels of interpretation. And so in this photograph, I really wanted to record this page, you know, this spread in particular, just so that there is always a record of it being outside the institution. Even if it's a commemorative space, right, that is completely aligned with the things that I think about, I think it's important to navigate that access. And I'll break open after this because I feel like we're getting close to time, but the last thing I'll say in relationship to this photograph is that my Aunt Charlene on the right, we're being led through, you know, they really gave us a good experience, you know, in donating this material. And we're being led through the space by the curator of the museum, the principal historian, and, you know, we're in the meeting house, and the curator is talking about, you know, your ancestors would have been witness to Frederick Douglass in this time, and they would have heard, you know, the most important speeches of the period. And my Aunt Charlene turns to me, and in her Rhode Island accent, she says, "I hate museums. I hate museums." And she said, "What do they have to do with me?" And I feel like that, you know, we were really cutting up, but like she, it's an apt critique, like that I'm still thinking about, like her relationship to that space. And then this photograph is a double exposure from a family reunion that they organized in Providence last year. So I think instead of, you know, narrating individual images, we can break open for questions, we can get the lights up. And I'm happy to answer anything about the show, about particular photographs, and about the sound work that's present in the space. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What is the sound that we're listening to in here? That's fine. What is that? And how does it relate back to the sound?
There are two channels in the space, so they're separated from left to right. In the left channel, it's sort of a distorted recording of a camera's shutter continuously flowing. So I recorded within a company that preserves family photographs in Boston. It's like a commercial, you know, interest. And I just recorded someone working, raising and lowering a camera, sort of copy stand, clicking the shutter again and again. And then the right channel is a narration that I'm reading of kind of a list poem. It's a list of 1 through 80, thesis on photography, yeah.
I'm just looking at the time. I just want to make an announcement. I know some of you need to leave, and it's okay.
If
you don't mind staying, I'm going to stay a little bit longer if you have questions and answers, or answers, so questions and answers. Anyone who needs to leave, like I said, feel free to.
Yeah, and thanks, folks, for your attention, and make sure to get pizza if you have to go.
So back to the audio.
Yeah. I mean, the narration, I have just titled it Simple Pictures. Like I wrote, it was originally supposed to be a slide lecture. It's funny that was working with slides, but it was 1 through 80. It was supposed to accompany this like 80 image slide lecture. And they're just these short sort of captions where I'm trying to like think about relationship of like the photograph to violence itself, and my like daily experience making the images. So some of the photographs in the exhibition have corresponding captions, like with the bluebird, you know, and the trees that are at the Du Bois birth site in Great Barrington.
I'm interested in the juxtaposition of the I can mean a lot to that.
Well, when I, you know, encountered that bird, I was having like a really, like I was looking for something, you know. So that bluebird was pecking at my windows, at each window of the house. And of course, I think it's like divine intervention, right? I'm like, okay, someone's trying to talk to me. But what was actually happening is that the bird was seeing his own reflection in the window and, yeah, you know, trying to like spar with himself for his territory. So, you know, that stemmed its own thing, but I was just thinking about that, the sort of like curiosity and joy I felt watching him, like watching that bird, and just observing the landscape, you know, in the space that I was in. And I wanted to think about, like what is this view, you know, from the interior of the enslaved, you know, like what is this, you know, what are the spaces of privacy and joy and practice they would have encountered in that quarters? And there's something about the windows that feels related, you know, like related in some form, like this idea of looking out the window, or as I've done here, covering the window, right? Like sort of closing off space from an exterior view as well. Like, so it's a loose connection, right? But yeah, I hope that answers, yeah, some of those thoughts. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Well, I think, I mean, I can pull the sound work up and we can have like more covert conversations between two. Yeah, one more.
I've had the occasion of getting here in the morning and kind of being with the sound and the image, you know, coming through the space, and then also hearing it kind of upstairs.
Yeah.
But what I notice is like your reverb on it, like you have this kind of like, so when something does move, it's like, you know.
Yeah.
And then when you're upstairs, that's all you hear kind of. And I was kind of curious about your choice for reverb. Like, is that, are you trying to position it in a memory space, and that's what's happening?
Yes, and I had visited this space before I started thinking about the installation, and because it is so open, I didn't want to disturb everyone's classes, but I knew that there would be sort of sound bleeding, you know, like out of the space, or, you know, bracketing off in other spaces, sort of when you're coming up the stairs or coming from the reverse. So in some ways I wanted, you know, and I'm really like not at this technical level yet, but I wanted the encounter to begin before you start to see the photographs, right? So you do hear that echo, or that echo is kind of, that reverb is kind of pulling you in. And then the vocal narration is like kind of much lower than that, right? So, yeah.
In terms of encountering it too, because you can walk in and actually, sometimes you're in the space for a while before it cycles back and you're like, oh, there's audio, there's breathless, or whatever. It's interesting how it does function and how the voice does play, but like sometimes it's pretty well inaudible, and then what you really are hearing are those kind of punctuated moments. That's fascinating.
I just had a question about, even just looking around, the only thing that they presented, and they're very poetic in their way, and that sort of relation back to history, even like the one of your aunts, of which, as a viewer, you know, walking through the space, I guess that's something of the warmth there, I feel a little more comfort of knowing them, say, than some of the other portraits. But it's not explicit, right? And like the choice to not keep titles, which seems so important. Even like this one I figured out, which on account of this much tree, of course, it's a very important place. So I'm curious about the choice to leave the text out of the wall, as how you negotiate that with yourself.
Yeah, it is an, it's hard in exhibitions, because I think in the slide form, like, I'm in control over the like lexical attraction of the text, like it's a one-to-one. But in the exhibition space, I feel like, you know, like the tombstone or the label holds too much interpretive power. And it is important to, I think, have some of the context of some of you know, this space in particular, or the like geographic location of some of the images. But I really like want to trust someone's interpretation of kind of giving the images a blind read, and like reading between the sequence, you know, the interstitial spaces in the sequence, and you know, sort of present some broad brushstrokes, and then if that curiosity continues, you know, there are, you know, there's a system of labeling elsewhere, or there's the context coming from the vocal narration that would take, you know, that piece loops for an hour. So it would take like just more engagement to get to it. And there's something there like about privacy and secrecy too that I'm interested in. Yeah. I also know it's frustrating because it's like, I want to know. Yeah.
So much of this layer of history, especially this one, where that history is not so visual, it's so embedded in the sort of background of the images, and both personal and just, you know, kind of generational. And so it's an interesting thing that we see it here with these, and this idea of the narrative of the story that you're on, and how that fits in.
And, you know, my art now students have been writing about it, and of course, like everyone, if you've noticed, okay, there are no labels under, which often you do, and I always make labels for the artwork. And I enjoy the idea of there's this other aspect that you were talking about, of having to find out what it all means, because you could just experience that on the level of, it's a nice picture of windows. And then, of course, it changes when people do work to read. So it's like two experiences.
And there are many, I mean, I think in relationship to, you know, the concepts that I presented in the slides, in Venus in Two Acts, Cydia Hartman, you know, also asks, like, how can we listen to the black noise of the archive, or that exists, as you said, as kind of the background noise in the archive, and not to, you know, rush to fill in the gaps of the interpretation. So it's kind of a conceptual idea that I'm trying to work out in exhibition form.
Yeah. Yeah, so you had said that most of the people were people that you didn't know. And something that I noticed is that there is like a feeling of like intimacy and closeness and like trust that you've established with people that are modeling for you. How did you do that? What was like your process with it?
Yeah, save for the figure of Day, she is actually like my only friend from high school. so like that relationship was there, and she's a musician, and there's a sound work related to that photograph or that moment that I'm still editing and working on, her actual singing in the making of the image, you know, the like, 15 minutes it took me to make the picture. You know, she's looping a piece that she's singing. The other figures I just approach, and I'm really trying to like come into like a language around portraiture and like how to photograph people. But something that I lead with is like honesty, you know, so I'm an artist. Some of, you know, this could be publicized, like this could circulate, are you okay with that? But those moments are, an artist who's now in Boston, Zora Murph, told me this once, like, you know, there's a lot of history around subjugating people in photographs, you know, capturing, quote unquote, capturing the other in the photograph. But in, you know, this sort of like quest or thought space that I'm on, it's an encounter between two black people. And even if that's not shown in the interpretation, like that moment of privacy between the two of us is a special encounter for me. So I make conversation and I'm working with the 810 camera, so it's slow. I mean, you'll notice, save for, you know, the gardeners or even in the double exposure photograph, the folks are stationary, you know, are kind of fixed in place. And that gives me the time to construct the frame and make the exposure. But often, you know, when you have that encounter, I feel like, you know, in these other two images where I had that encounter, you know, their eyes are closed and they're having their own, you know, before I arrived, you know, they were having their own you know, a historical, emotional, imaginative space, you know, whatever is happening in their life. Sometimes that they share, sometimes they don't. But, you know, it's sort of like that kind of like parallel universe theory, right? Like two points meeting each other in the moment of the photograph. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's hard to approach people though, right?
It is hard.
And Nick knows. Yeah. Yeah.
How long did you spend with like Francis and Donna?
Yeah. That was a long time. That was the photograph was made in the middle of a walk to that pond and then a walk back. So there was like a long preamble and conversation before I even took out the camera. Yeah.
And you said you're shooting with the 810 camera.
Yeah. It's good for the...
Are you trying to like establish a connection with that person that you can relate
to? Yeah, yeah. And I always, you know, request, you know, like a follow-up, you know, or like I'm seeking to have continued encounters, relationships with folks. And sometimes people are open to that and sometimes like they are not. Yeah, yeah. Okay, I think we should, we can disband into covert groups of two, yeah. Thanks, folks.